explicate it to for ordinary users to understand that why, in case of say debt instrument, the impairment can be reversed through the P&L account, and why, in case of equity instruments, the impairment cannot be reversed through the P&L account. So there are logical inconsistencies within the standard. Now, by reducing all those categories and requiring only fair value accounting in all cases other than limited circumstances where a loan meets certain criteria for amortized cost accounting, it has to be amortized, measured at amortized cost, perhaps from the user perspective, it will be easy for them to comprehend, okay, this is the way the financial instruments are accounted for on the balance sheet. So all the assets are at fair value and the gain or loss to the P&L, but there are certain assets like loans and receivable which are carried. So actually we are going back to the, say, accounting which was somehow before IAS 39, you know, a simple approach and easy for regulators to understand, but I also agree that there are challenges within IFRS 9 of application as well. Say as unquoted equity investments to be fair valued is a very big challenge, and sometimes applying this business model test may become extremely difficult in certain practical situations. So, you know, I recognize that there will be complexities, but compared to IS 39, I would say it will give a relief.
My question basically revolves around the business models.
Identify yourself. And
my name is Umair Ghor Shafiq. I'm an assistant manager with AF Ferguson & Company. My question is basically regarding the business model test and the creation of a portfolio. Now, when you're talking about a bank, it has various different divisions, like the corporate division. The corporate division will be providing loans and in cases investing in TFCs of SMEs and corporates, unquoted TFCs. Now, when we move to the treasury division of the bank, it will be investing in TFCs with a different nature. And then when you go to syndicate financing, it will be again financing different companies through various methods, including TFCs, being the nature of quoted and unquoted. Now, in these three different divisions, the purpose of the investment will be different. Syndicate and corporate will invest with a long-term nature, while the treasury might invest with a shorter-term profit-making nature. So, won't it involve additional complications for the auditors and they're evaluating the accounting behind these, what do you say, accounting treatment and accounting policy behind these classifications? And does IFRS 9 deal with these issues, or does it provide additional guidance or restrictions on these issues?
You know, business model is something, is an accounting estimate and assessment. That estimate has to come from the management, that what is the portfolio and what is the purpose of holding the portfolio. See, in a corporate book, if the portfolio is comprising of unquoted investments and TFCs which are unquoted, not tradable actively in the market, and the purpose of that portfolio is to collect all the repayments by the bank directly, and the purpose is not to sell those instruments in the market and realize any fair value changes that may happen between the purchase and the maturity of the instrument, then apparently the portfolio meets the business model test. The business model objective is to collect the cash flows rather than selling the instrument on a frequent basis. Whereas in a treasury department or various instruments are held where the entity wants to realize the fair value gains or losses on a portfolio basis, and the objective is not to collect the contractual cash flows. Now, in practice, the entities have to declare as to what is their business model, and that is a judgment which the entities would make, and the auditors have to also endorse that judgment through their opinions. But you know, yes, I agree with you, this business model is a concept which is new to the accounting world, and as far as IFRS 9 is concerned, it contains very less guidance on determination of business model, and perhaps as the standard will be implemented, I think IFRIC will release more guidance and application material on its application to different businesses, not only banks and financial institutions, but sometimes to the manufacturing and service organization, industrial organizations also. It is challenging, but you know, it is something, again, can be assessed and a judgment can be made. But one important aspect is, once you make that judgment, you're not allowed to then change that judgment, because your business model can not change each year, right? So that is a challenge, but I think, is, again, this is something which can be done.
My name is Asmat Sayed. I'm working with Deloitte. My question with you is that regarding the equity, as you mentioned earlier, that as per the new standards, we can see that most of the equity instruments now fall into the fair value model rather than the, with certain exemptions of the non-trading equities. So the problem here we have seen in earlier, the recent problem in the crisis was the fair value models, because if we are going for the fair value models for some equity in, instruments where we don't have actual the market, the relative fair value market, so that gives the problem would be it would be this fair value which we are calculating would be more judgmental and subjective, and yeah, that was actually the cause of that old crisis we had earlier. In 2008 till 2010 is still going on. So don't you think so? That is adding to the problem, not actually bringing back to going for the solution.
Well, I agree that it will add greater subjectivity to the financial statements, because unquoted equity investments, when required to be valued on a fair value basis, you need to then value them using certain valuation models, which then would depend on various assumptions of business data, present and future, and this would add to the subjectivity. But the only issue is that, you know, since all the instruments or the majority of the instruments on the balance sheet will be carried at fair value, so from a user perspective, if certain portion is not fair valued, so it may impact the economic decisions when reading the financial statement. So, you know, for example, if an investor is reading the financial statement and he knows that there is a certain component of equity instrument which is unquoted and which is not fair valued, so, you know, sometimes if unless you have gone through whole accounting policy and all that, so it's difficult to comprehend that there are certain instruments which are not exactly fair valued and not reflecting their true value on the balance sheet. The first of all, there is a technical merit in requiring all assets to be fair valued. After all, unquoted equity investments have a fair value, and if you do not present them at fair value, you are not basically recognizing the full economic reality behind the balance sheet. So technically speaking and theoretically speaking, it makes more sense to value them on a fair value basis. But yes, practically, there may be a compromise on the reliability of the valuation because of subjectivity involved, etc. But I think this can be overcome by requiring extensive disclosures on how you have valued the unquoted equity investments, what assumptions you have used, sensitivity analysis and all that. And also, we have to keep in mind the fact that, you know, out of the total proportion of assets, normally the unquoted portion is not very large. So yes, it will add some complexity into the process, but it might be not be very, very significant.
My name is Farhan Abbas. I am from Anjua, and I'm working as assistant manager there. My question is regarding the business model test, which is the new concept, as you have already mentioned. My question is that in IAS 39, in held to maturity investments, in which there was intention and ability of entity to hold it, the entity used to classify it as in held to maturity. But here we have a business model test in which it says that entity has to hold it, but
as the standard says that the changes in the business model will be infrequent. But coming to the Pakistani scenario, if somebody wants to change the business model based on like